Vislik, do you know what the human crew members are keeping in that crate of theirs? Crassly asked the Zik crew member, who was supervising him in unloading a new shipment. He ducked slyly to make eye contact properly with the slimy-looking director. Also, what does Dracaris mean? The strange word had been stamped across the equally strange crate. The wooden box stunk slightly, having reinforced with iron bars running across the lid, and also, it seemed to have air holes punched into the sides. There were vaguely threatening growling noises emanating from it. Vislik merely looked over his clipboard with mild annoyance. In one tentacle he held a pen poised to attack his inventory list. In another, a steaming cup of the stimulant the humans called coffee. Vislik needed his fix before properly functioning in the morning ever since human Sophie had introduced it to him 3 months ago. Krautly, despite being relatively new to the base and intellectually out of his depth, had deep misgivings about the supposedly harmless beverage that the humans, and now several Zilk, were so dependent on. But any time he broached the subject, he was met with universal hostility, so he had learned to let it slide. With two spare appendages, Vislik gestured for Krautly to place the strange crate aside, carefully. Krautly did as he was told, grunting slightly as he picked it up. Something definitely shifted inside it, and the growling noises turned into a roar. Krautly clicked in alarm and nearly dropped it. When just a flame shot out free of the breathing holes, he did drop it. It tumbled down the ramp and landed scarcely a hand's breadth from one of Vislik's tentacles. He sprung out of the way, spilling his coffee in the process. His upper membrane flashed an assortment of colours at the unfortunate Kralatin in what was the equivalent of a glare. The meaning was entirely lost on Krautly, who up until 3 months ago had never met a Zilk. On the edge of Krautly's senses, he could hear a low whine coming from the now upside down box. Just then, human Eva burst into the hangar. "What's going on? Is anyone hurt?" she demanded, wielding a wrench. Human Eva was still in the adolescent stage, being what other humans called a teenager. She and four other humans had arrived shortly after Commander Joseph Thorne announced that his wife and children would be going to live at the research outpost on a permanent basis. The crew had, of course, been suitably warned about this particular subspecies of human in a memo from Sapient Resources. Privately, Krautly didn't think Human Eva was that bad, just a little impulsive. Human Eva crossed the hangar in a flash, swinging the wrench at her side carelessly. She looked up at Krautly expectantly. He only shook his head sheepishly. It was a gesture he picked up from her and the other humans. Her face scrunched into a frown, a trait most other species couldn't help but find adorable. "Friend Eva," said Vislik, regaining his composure, "you should not be here. The commander informed me that you and your broodmates would be totally engaged today in your education." Vislik turned to gather the shards of the coffee mug and his clipboard. As soon as he did, human Eva made a face and stuck her tongue out at him. Krautly was amazed that a creature that looked almost indistinguishable from an adult could still be so childish. Then she flashed her teeth at him as if he was in on some private joke. It sent a shiver down his spine, but he attempted to return it. The effort only made human Eva double over laughing. More flame shot out of the box, accompanied by a long, sorrowful whine. Human Eva's two large round eyes widened even more as she rushed over to the crate. "Oh no! Whatever happened to poor Lola?" she exclaimed anxiously. "What is a Lola?" Krautly asked hesitantly, coming down the ramp and crouching beside her as she began attacking the bolts with her wrench. "Lola is her name, you big goof," said Human Eva flippantly. "She's my pet." "Pet?" asked Krautly at a loss. The crate was taller than she was, and she jumped ineffectually at the top two bolts. Wordlessly, she handed the wrench up to Krautly, who took over. "Oh no you don't," exclaimed Vislik, gliding over to them with a fresh cup of coffee. "There is no way that thing is safe." When neither the Kralantin nor the human took notice, the Vislik flung his pen at Krautly. "Stop opening the obviously dangerous bin, you half-formed sea slug." Krautly looked at him with a mildly puzzled expression. "But human friend Eva said..." Human Eva's expression could have curdled milk as she stomped over to the Zilk. "Krautly isn't a slug and Lola isn't dangerous." She might have said more, but just then, the side of the crate burst open and the sleek red creature streaked past Krautly and pinned Human Eva to the floor. Oh, stars. That thing was trying to eat her, thought Fuzzluck helplessly. He closed his eye and flashed a multitude of different colours before turning completely invisible and slipping quietly out of the room. He dreaded having to report to the commander that Human Eva had been mauled to death by a giant winged lizard in Hangar 4. He had three other offspring after all, so hopefully the loss wouldn't be too devastating. Crowdly, to his credit, leapt up immediately and attempted to pull the creature off human friend Eva by its tail. In hindsight, he realised that might not have been the best idea, as the beast only landed on him instead, breathing fire and growling. Crowdly yelped as the flame singed his fur. He backed away, looked around wildly for some kind of weapon before he could lunge and finish him off. To his shock and horror, friend Eva was laughing again. He was glad to see she was alive, but being nearly eaten must have made her hysterical. Lola, she called in a sing-song voice. Of course, the beast did not respond, and Crowdly found himself backed against the wall. Eva, he cried, forgetting the honorific. Get out of here, run! Human Eva did not run. Lola, heal, she snapped. Hey, come here. To Crowdly's horror, the winged beast bounded back over to her, quick as lightning. He started forward, but to his surprise, the monster only knelt down beside her. Good girl, crooned the tiny human. She reached into her back pocket and pulled out a strip of dried meat, involuntarily making Crowdly's nostrils wrinkle. Crowdly is a friend, she continued soothingly. Human Eva began stroking the monster's flank, and cautiously, it took a few steps forward. He swallowed. What is that thing? Human Eva flashed her teeth at him again. Next to the beast, the gesture was almost reassuring. I told you, this is Lola, my pet dragon. They wouldn't let her come with us on the passenger shuttle, so Papa had to get her shipped specially. Human Eva gave the dragon another affectionate pat. I'm sorry if she scared you. I don't think anyone bothered to feed her during the trip, and being stuck in that box couldn't have been much fun. So she was trying to eat you? Clarified Crowdly nervously. Human Eva only laughed again and pulled his hand towards the beast's head. She likes being scratched behind the ears, she explained, but I'm too short to reach them normally. Crowdly had to quash a jolt of panic before he could bring himself to touch Lola's head. To his surprise, the creature's body was surprisingly warm. It was almost comforting. Lola wasn't so bad now that she was no longer growling or breathing fire at him. And anyway, the dragon barely came up to his waist. The creature's long, whip-thin tail oscillated back and forth. A low vibrating noise came from deep in his throat, and two smoke tendrils rose from both nostrils and between the creature's teeth. Crowdly clicked in alarm and drew back, but Lola nuzzled her head towards him. See, she likes you, laughed Human Eva. Before he could respond, Commander Thorne strode into the hangar. Reflexively, Crowdly stood back a few paces. The commander had a sour expression on his face, though that was likely because Vizsluk was sliding along beside him, talking incessantly. Vizsluk, don't ever tell me that you left my daughter to get mauled by a dangerous beast just to save your own skin, snapped the commander. Crowdly had never heard Human Thorne so angry. And no, I don't care how harmless that beast turns out to be. His face brightened again, when he turned to see his daughter and the dragon. Good to see that Lola made it in one piece, he said, voice booming across the hangar despite his small stature. Though I would have preferred if you'd let her out in the garden. Human Eva smiled at her father, apologetically. He gave the dragon a strip of meat and stroked the side of her neck. We were lucky she's such a young dragon. I don't think I could have found a courier service to deliver her otherwise. Before he could stop himself, Crowdly clicked in surprise. Commander Thorne blinked a few times and looked up at the Kralatin, as if realizing he was there for the first time. Sir, does that mean she'll get bigger? The commander blinked again. Why, yes, of course. She'll be at least twice this size when she's an adult. Does that mean she'll be big enough for us to ride it, Papa? Asked Human Eva excitedly. I think so, he responded, grinning. Crowdly felt the sudden need to sit down.